Hola, bona tarda a tothom. Gràcies per haver vingut. No crec que... Bueno, però si fa falta la autopresentació, jo soc Pepe Pardo de la institució Milà i Fontanals i del Consell Directiu de la Societat. Quan es va organitzar, quan la Comissió de Col·loquis de la Societat Catalana d'Història de la Ciència... de la Ciència, i de la tècnica va organitzar el cicle temàtic aquest de geografies del coneixement, se'n va acudir proposar de fer l'acte d'avui, agafant l'aparició del llibre de Massimiano Bucchi, El pollo di Newton, on es parla de cuina i de ciència, pensar que la metàfora aquesta de geografia del coneixement no sols es tractava de geografies i de territoris, diguem, a macroescala, sinó que també eren geografies del coneixement, els espais, els llocs de la casa, la ciutat o el carrer on es fa o en alguna cosa entra o ix la ciència o alguna cosa de històricament ha tingut alguna cosa a dir o alguna cosa a fer en el present i en el passat. Per això a mi em semblava que el llibre de Massimiano era ideal. Però a més el pretext era ideal també per una raó, perquè ve a través de la societat catalana, ve a través de la Milà i Fontanals i del nostre grup i d'Oliver i de molta gent que hem seguit l'obra de Massimiano Bucchi des de fa molts anys i que hem intentat diverses voltes ajustar agendes per a fer possible la seva vinguda. Ara recorde, ara que entra la Clara, ella ho recorda també perfectament, com l'Oliver, l'intentarem per a l'escola de primavera de Mahó, l'hem intentat diverses voltes perquè ha sigut una persona i una obra i una trajectòria que sempre ens ha interessat d'alguna manera. I ens ha interessat fins al punt de que sabeu els que sou o heu estat estudiants del màster i del doctorat, que sempre hi ha hagut alguna referència, alguna cosa de Massimiano Bucchi en les nostres bibliografies. No vull citar-les totes les seues obres, però vull recordar-vos que el llibre escrit con Neresini, publicat en el 2006, és un llibre habitual en les nostres bibliografies. Però també els llibres anteriors de Bucchi, com el primer Science in Andemilia de l'any 98 en Routledge, o La Scienza in Pubblico que va publicar en edició italiana el títol La Scienza in Pubblico, o el llibre que en el 2002 va publicar en italià en Il Mulino Scienza e Società, que è stato tradotto poi due anni dopo com Science in Society en Routledge, sempre. Bé, són llibres, ja dic, que han figurat en les nostres bibliografies, perquè la societat i en el nostre màster aquest interès cap als estudis, els STS, aquests d'estudis de ciència i tecnologia, els estudis de ciència i societat, sempre han estat, diguem, objecte d'interès i a la vegada, de vegades, de crítica per la manca de vegades sensibilitat històrica, de vegades una perspectiva històrica adequada o un ús de la història de la ciència en aquests terrenys d'estudi sobre la ciència que no ens acabava de convèncer. I en canvi, l'apropament de Bucchi sempre ens ha aparegut des d'aquest punt de vista impecable o almenys no tan criticable o no criticable com els altres. I no és casualitat perquè ell, evidentment, té, encara que el seu PhD és de ciència política social en l'Institut Universitari Europeu i ensenya en una facultat de sociologia i és sociòleg de la ciència, però té una formació històrica i una formació d'historiador de la ciència indubtable. La gràcia afegida d'aquest llibre és que és un llibre realment on la història està des del principi fins al final i està al servei d'un discurs molt atractiu contínuament prenyat de reflexions sobre la relació entre ciència i societat. I ho fa, a més, en un llenguatge i en una clara voluntat d'arribar a un públic molt, molt ample, Aquesta és una qüestió que també ens ha preocupat en altres cicles de la societat, no? Aquell cicle que fèrem sobre divulgació i divulgació de la ciència i divulgació d'història de la ciència. Per tant, hi havia moltes ocasions per a poder convidar a Massimiano. Ens ha semblat que l'aparició del llibre en la seva versió italiana, però apareixerà i esperem fins i tot que tingui alguna edició espanyola, era un bon moment i afortunadament finalment les agendes han quadrat i hem pogut comptar amb Massimiano. No m'enrotllo més, vos el deixe i ell, com havia estat anunciat, farà la seva intervenció en anglès, també perquè estem en connexió i pensàvem que era la llengua menys conflictiva, però evidentment en el debat aquí amb vosaltres podeu emprar català, castellà, italià, anglès, alemany fins i tot. Una persona que ha estudiat i treballa en Trento, ni tan sols l'alemany és un idioma estrany per a ell. Gràcies, Massimiano, i quan vulgui.
Thank you, Pepe Pardo and colleagues for inviting me. I'm very honored to speak here in this beautiful place about this little book. I will start by showing you a very short video. It's in Italian but with English subtitles. From the Italian TV show about science.
Inauguriamo ora una rubrica molto curiosa che continuerà ogni settimana, la scienza in cucina, perché i cuochi sono a loro modo degli inventori di reazioni chimiche. Ogni settimana affronteremo uno dei tanti aspetti della scienza in cucina e oggi cominceremo dalla maionese. La maionese è una specie di miracolo perché partendo da tre cose liquide, cioè olio, uova, succo di limone, costruisce una cosa così densa che un cucchiaino può starci piantato dentro come una bandiera. Ma qual è il segreto? Beh, a tutti è capitato di sbagliare una maionese, di farla impazzire, come si dice, senza capire bene il perché. Come si fa a evitare che la maionese vada male? Per cominciare, Michelangelo Pepe è andato a porre qualche domanda a un certo numero di persone per sondare la loro cultura sulla maionese. Ecco le loro risposte.
Tu quante volte l'anno la fai?
Cosa?
La maionese.
La maionese? Io personalmente, io non l'ho mai fatta, veramente.
Ci pensa mia moglie, mi suocera.
Sì, con l'uovo, il limone, l'uovo, limone e poi basta.
Uova e l'olio?
Forse un po' di prezzemolo tritato.
Passate, cioè, con la farina... Cioè, sì, lo so, insomma, però non me lo ricordo adesso.
Normalmente con olio, uova, perché?
Praticamente viene emulsionato l'uovo con l'olio.
E il meccanismo per cui si forma la maionese?
No, non lo so, sarà una fermentazione, non lo so.
Come sarebbe il meccanismo perché stanno insieme gli ingredienti? Che mi ha detto, non lo so.
La maionese l'ha mai fatta?
No, I didn't speak Italian.
E impazzisce la maionese?
Oddio, non è che ci vado pazza, eh?
Come impazzisce?
Cosa bisogna fare quando impazzisce?
Non lo so, buttarla.
Lei quante volte all'anno la fa?
Almeno 9-10 mesi all'anno.
La maionese?
Mai fatta, la compro già fatta.
Limone? E uova.
La maionese va girata sempre dallo stesso verso.
E perché c'è qualche cosa che la fa smontare? Non sappiamo nessuno se perché, non credo che esista un perché.
Impazzisce per diversi motivi, può essere la temperatura sbagliata delle uova, la temperatura sbagliata dell'uovo.
Tutti gli ingredienti devono essere freddi. L'importante è questo, sia l'olio che le uova. Devono essere poste in frigorifero un paio d'ore.
Probabilmente ci metto parecchio olio tutto insieme perché se mi si stanca il braccio e quindi impazzisce.
Quando impazzisce c'è un sistema per recuperarla?
È molto difficile, però di solito si usa per aggiungere un tuorlo a parte, ricominciare il montaggio con un tuorlo e poi piano piano aggiungere la maionese impazzita.
Durante un temporale la faresti la maionese?
No, ma qual è la maionese durante il temporale? No.
No, mai.
Perché?
Perché vorrei dormire e stare sotto le coperte.
Ci sono alcune dicerie che parlano di temporali, parlano di donne in certi periodi, parlano di influenza, di febbre, temperature alte della persona che le esegue, di disposizioni. pare che contribuiscano a non farla montare.
Ma lo sa che impazzisce la maionese?
Sì, ma non come con le donne in genere.
Grazie.
Ognuno insomma ha una sua teoria, noi abbiamo la nostra e per sperimentarla abbiamo realizzato una candid camera. Con il pretesto di un concorso per il miglior piatto decorato con la maionese e con la complicità della nostra amica Maralba, abbiamo installato delle telecamere nascoste in una scuola privata di arte culinaria. Le signore per preparare il loro piatto dovevano innanzitutto realizzare la maionese con gli ingredienti che c'erano tutti perfettamente regolari, uova, olio, succo di limone. Ecco il risultato.
It doesn't work. They cannot make mayonnaise. There's something wrong.
Non c'è niente da fare, dice.
Eh no, oramai, guarda. Non si riprende più.
A me questa chiusetta non è bene. Mi sbaglierò. Ma che brava che si sta andando via? Perché mi sta prendendo troppo olio. Ma cosa va?
La maionese non monta, niente da fare. Ogni candidata, malgrado gli sforzi, si ritrova disperatamente con la maionese andata male. E addio concorso per il miglior piatto decorato. In realtà siamo stati noi, naturalmente, ad inserire nella prova un piccolo trucco per far impazzire la maionese. Quale? Ne parleremo tra poco, per capirlo sarebbe però bene iniziare cosa succede quando la maionese monta normalmente. Semplifichiamo molto le cose. Si prende dunque olio, tuorlo d'uovo e succo di limone. Per capire il meccanismo abbiamo messo in questo contenitore che vedete dell'acqua e dell'olio. Se si sbatte si formano goccioline d'olio separate. Più si sbatte, più diventano piccole, questo tutti lo sanno. Dopo un po' di tempo, però, queste goccioline d'olio, tendono a ricongiungersi nuovamente. Ecco, già lo si può osservare. Nel giro di qualche minuto l'olio si ricompone in chiazze sempre più grandi e alla fine troveremo nuovamente olio e acqua separati. Olio e acqua, in altre parole, non stanno insieme. Nella maionese, invece, le cose vanno diversamente. Nella maionese, infatti, c'è dell'acqua, 50% del tuorlo d'uovo è composto d'acqua e anche nel limone c'è acqua. Eppure in questo caso acqua e olio si legano. Come mai? Il segreto sta in questa sostanza, si chiama lecitina e si trova nel tuorlo d'uovo. Se noi torniamo dalla nostra miscela d'acqua e di olio versando dentro della lecitina e la sbattiamo nuovamente, le goccioline d'olio questa volta non si ricongiungeranno più, rimarranno separate. Perché?
Perché questa lecitina va a disporsi tutto intorno alle goccioline d'olio, formando uno strato di molecole che, verso l'esterno, hanno tutte una carica elettrica dello stesso segno. E così, come due poli dello stesso segno di una calamita si respingono, analogamente le goccioline d'olio, a questo punto, tendono a respingersi e non si ricongiungono più. Non solo, ma queste molecole di lecitina nella parte esterna sono idrofile, cioè si legano all'acqua. E tutta la struttura in questo modo tiene insieme.
Ma è un equilibrio instabile, basta poco a farlo crollare. Nel nostro caso abbiamo adottato un piccolo trucco per far impazzire la maionese. Nell'olio abbiamo inserito un pizzico di antiemulsionante, cioè una particolare sostanza che sembra un po' al sale, che agisce in senso contrario alla lecitina. È bastato questo a far crollare la costruzione e a far impazzire la maionese.
E niente, non va. Non va. Anche per verificare tante volte si può sentire.
most famous science TV program in Italy. This section is called Science in the Kitchen, and this program has been going on for more than 30 years in prime time television with an audience between 4 and 5 million. And I started my book, my interest for science and cooking, from this section. And one of the reasons why I find it interesting is that it embeds and contains a certain, I would say, ideology of science in public, which is a bit unusual. If you compare it, for example, with a certain type of popularization or public communication of science, if you think about, for example, astrophysics, where the public is invited to enjoy something very distant from ordinary experience, something which is maybe aesthetically fascinating, extraordinary. While here, science is intruding into everyday life, is coming to take the common sense by the hand and upgrade it to a new type of knowledge. So it's sort of it's a different strategy which doesn't contradict common sense. Starts from something that everybody knows or think they know. And you also noticed that in order to make room for the triumphal appearance of science to enlighten what's happening, for example, in mayonnaise, they have to downgrade common sense. For example, if you notice these interviews, which were almost a literal representation of common sense. You know, the man in the street, Alfred Schütz, a famous philosopher and sociologist, used this expression, the man on the street. Many of the questions were deliberately misleading or incomplete. And actually, they had to play a trick, put something so the mayonnaise doesn't come, so common sense doesn't work. The routine of making things, which is the basis of common sense, doesn't work anymore, so science has to come in. So this was the beginning of my interest. It was something which goes back 15 years ago. I never thought I would write a book about science and cooking, but then all sorts of examples and stories came to me, and interesting ideas about, as Pepe was explaining, this is actually a book about science and society, but from the using the kitchen as an angle. And finally, the idea was to put all of these stories, and because this, except for the last two pages, is not a book for sociologists, is not a book for academics. It's a series of stories about scientists and science and cooking and food with a sort of light socio-historical thesis which appears in the end explicitly. And it's organized like a menu. So there is an antipasto, which actually starts from the mayonnaise story. And I'm going to talk in a minute about this antipasto. Then there's the main course is about the chicken. The chicken appears in all sorts of ways in the interaction between science and cooking, science and society, real chicken, like famous Francis Bacon or Newton's chicken, metaphorical chicken in philosophy, in social sciences, in political theory. There are drinks on the side. I don't know if you have this custom. When I was a child, I used to go on holiday in the seaside in the Adriatic coast of Italy, and the typical pensione, which is modest hotel where you have your meals, but then the drinks would be on the side, so you'll have to pay separately, which is about beer, wine, coffee, tea, chocolate, and controversies. I'm going also to talk about this. And then there is a dessert, which is the more, if you wish, theoretical part about how this relates to science and society interactions. And finally, there is an index of ingredients. Of course, I will not have the time to tell everything, but let me start from a few examples. I'm sure you have all similar examples also here in Catalonia or in Spain, but the idea of this TV show that I just showed you, it's certainly not new or not original, because we can find all sorts of books. Here is a list of mostly from the UK, United States, recipes for science fun, the science cookbook, the Epicurean laboratory, the science of cooking, what Einstein told his cook, science in the kitchen, and so on. So all books that use cooking and the kitchen to communicate science. This is a game from Italy. You find in every game store for children, laboratory in the kitchen. In science museums, you find a lot of installations. So this idea of communicating science through the kitchen, as I was mentioning, certainly touches something relevant in the interaction between science and society. But then, if we go back, I mean, the book doesn't, deliberately doesn't follow an historical order, because I prefer to, I thought it was nicer for the reader to go through the topics rather than in chronological order. But if we go back, of course, in history, we find a lot of examples of how cookery was taught in a scientific or proto-scientific way. Here you see the dissection of a boiled hen from a sort of manual of cooking. You see it resembles very much an anatomical dissection. And this is a very early example, 1615, the English housewife, and one of the virtues of the housewife, as you see, must be to have skill in physics, beside, of course, cookery, banqueting, and so on. This is a classic from an Italian treatise describing arts and crafts, Tommaso Garzoni, Piazza Universale delle Professioni del Mondo, and he makes a comparison between butchers and anatomists. He says butchers and anatomists do a very similar job, but the difference, of course, is anatomists skin and dismember human dead bodies, sometimes cut living bodies, while the butchers tear apart and dismember animal bodies with much less pity. So this parallel was there from the very beginning, also of modern science, but it became really powerful, especially in the 19th century. And here there are a few examples of this idea, which was really associated with the flowering of publication, that cookery itself should become a science. So the sort of impulse to the scientificization of cookery. Here you have an example on the left, Friedrich Haku, a chemist writing culinary chemistry, exhibiting the scientific principles of cookery. And then there are two classics that you probably know, the Physiologie du goût, Brillat-Savarin, which is part of a whole strand of popular publication which had physiology in the title, the physiology of sex, the physiology of sleeping. And this was the Physiology of Taste, which is still printed. And in the beginning of this book, the basic idea, as I said, Brillat-Savarin was a jurist. He was not a scientist himself, but he was very much influenced by the idea that cookery, like other activities, had to become scientific. So he starts his book with his aphorism, which says, for the benefit of mankind, it's more important, it is of more benefit, a new culinary dish than the discovery of a new planet. So this idea that cooking has all the right to make its way among the sciences. And here is the, I'm sorry, I cannot see very well, but I suppose it is translated in Spanish and even in Catalan, because it's the most, oh, thank you. It's the most widely Italian translated book worldwide after Pinocchio, and it's called La Scienza in Cucina, Science in the Kitchen. And it was published in 1891 by a merchant entrepreneur who had a passion for cooking. And the title reflects, I mean, it would be interesting to speak about a little bit about this book, because the author, Pellegrino Artusi, was certainly in touch with some relevant Italian scientists of the time. Actually, it's quite funny that if you look at some of the receipts, before the receipt, for example, the, I don't know how you call the rombo, I don't even know the English, you know, the fish with the So before the giving the recipe, Pellegrino Artusi is giving the taxonomical, zoological description. And this was probably coming from Enrico Giglioli, who was a famous Italian naturalist of the time, was a friend of him. And another scientist was a popularizer, very successful popularizer of the time, who was very important for this book, was Paolo Mantegazza, was an anthropologist, medical doctor. His books were extremely popular. His lectures were followed by thousands of people. At some point, this book was self-published in the beginning. No publisher, I think it's a rather common story, no publisher wanted this book. At some point, Mantegazza wrote an endorsement and said, this is going to be an important book because it will make more healthy and more sort of appropriate. There was this sort of idea, a bit moralistic at the time, that people should be educated, and they should also be educated in cooking. And this was one of the keys for the success of the book. You can imagine, I don't know what is the equivalent, but I don't know, maybe Stephen Hawking or Richard Dawkins today endorsing a book, and of course this helped a lot. But basically, the key idea was that at this point, science has already become a powerful social force, a powerful cultural force. You can think, for example, to Jules Verne novels to have an idea of how this epic of science was profoundly embedded already in popular culture. And I think this is the main reason, beside, of course, his personal contacts, that led Pellegrino Artusi, who didn't know much about science, to use this title, Science in the Kitchen. And these are other examples of this phenomenon, the science of nutrition, the chemistry of cooking and cleaning, the chemistry of cookery, science in the daily meal, principle of cooking, a textbook. These are books, and these are journals. Mother's Friend, Heart at Home, the Ladies' Home Journal. Some scholars also have argued that the flowering of this, which will become in some countries domestic science or some equivalent, was also related, was also a way of sort of letting women come into science. Women were starting, of course, to study and to aspire to be part of the world of science in a confined space. So the idea that could be a space in science adapt to women. And this I find extraordinary, this cover. Another very successful book. 1 year after Artusi, same title, Science in the Kitchen. You see in the top right, actually scientific tools portrayed. And this is what she says in the introduction. Basically, you see, it's the same argument that of the TV show, that it's she finds amazing that in the age of science, in the age of progress, the preparation of food has been less advanced by the results of chemistry and physics than any other department of human industry. So the heart of cookery is lagging behind in the march of scientific progress. The mistress of the kitchen is still groping her way amid the uncertainties of medieval methods, using the rule of the thumb, and the chemistry of cookery is little known to the average housewife. And you see this very interesting comparison. So the housewife not enlightened by science is rarely more successful than misguided alchemist in transmuting lead and copper into silver and gold. So the cooking is described as in a pre-scientific state. So the new cookery, the one which is advocated in book, will be characterized by the elucidation of principles which govern the operation of the kitchen with the same certainty with which the law of gravity rules the planets. So the same certainty, the same way of operating of physics and chemistry will come to cooking. Of course, this is also a story of famous scientists and great entrepreneurs like Justus von Liebig. This is one of the most striking examples, who was probably one of the most visible, if not the most visible, European chemist of the time. And at some time, and at some point, with another associate, he started a very successful, what will become a very successful company. And but very interesting is the fact that some of his, especially some medical doctors at some point, he was making this meat extract. And at some point, he started to receive criticism from colleagues, especially medical doctors, about the actual nutritional value of this meat extract. And there was a very funny criticism by a medical doctor who wrote that Liebig's meat extract were in the same relation to meat as a Hamlet piece without Hamlet to the Shakespeare Hamlet. So it was like voided, like only the ghost of meat was only there. But Liebig understood at that point that there was another public who was very much ready and willing to embrace this innovation, even if the colleagues were criticist about it. And it was the people, especially women, who were actually making food every day. And for them, the meat extract was something very convenient, time-wise, money-wise. Of course, later on, people realized that you could, for example, when there was a big problem with local meat, I think, especially in Britain, meat could be imported using this extract from Latin America. So he devised a very big strategy, for example, targeting this public, the women who were making food, and using, for example, paying famous writers of the time who were writing about cooking to write little books of recipes to make with the meat extra to give as a gift. And he devised a very innovative type of marketing, which is this collecting cards that you can still buy on eBay, that you see ad on one side, ad very often scenes from Liebig's laboratory. So you the scientist himself, and on the back you see very interesting, we were talking about scientific expert today, his signature, so sort of confirming the scientific value. And this started to become very popular thing to collect at the time. Sociologists of science and historians of science are very interested in controversies, and there are lots of controversies about food and especially about drinks. Now, to put it very briefly and very roughly, especially in the beginning of modern science, of course, what scientists are doing, it's something very new, and one way of communicating what they are doing and making it relevant, for example, to the aristocrats or to people in the court, was to relate it with food, which was something everybody was familiar with. And moreover, at the time, there were a lot of new drinks coming from Europe, like coffee, tea, chocolate. This is a picture, of course, it's from a later time, of Garraway's, which is a coffee place, was one of the two coffee places. The other one was Gretchen, where the members of the Royal Society used to go after their meetings. There was this famous story that Newton didn't go after a very controversial meeting with Hooke because he wanted to claim priority for the discovery of the gravitation, and he didn't want to discuss this further in the coffee place. But it was also a place for making experiments itself. For example, Hooke, he had to do an experiment about the rotation of the Earth, so he had to throw, un grave, an object, from a very high point, and he decided to do it at Garraway's with his assistant. So you can imagine people having coffee and Hooke and his assistant making this experiment. Coffee as a drink is something many scientists write about, many scientists are interested in. Of course, one of the questions is it good or bad for the health? For example, Willis, famous medical doctor and writer of medical books at the time, has this, which is quite typical, I think, of medicine at the time, this approach saying that coffee is good for certain people, the people who are phlegmatic, the people who are I think he uses this expression, lethargic, people who need to wake up, but it's not good for people who are already nervous and thin. Linnaeus, of course, later on, he was very interested in coffee. He will devise the Coffea Arabica classification. He will try to grow coffee in Sweden, but without success. There is a petition by the women's of London against coffee, which is employing a great deal of scientific expertise and the advice of several doctors of the time. You see what is their concern with regard to coffee, that it's inconvenient for the sex of men because it's a drying, enfeebling liquor. And so they are asking the king to banish coffee. And this is also a common idea of the time, that coffee, since it comes from very dry, very hot places, it's a drying drink. And this is the response, the men's answer to the women's petition, 1674, saying the opposite and using opposite medical advice, that coffee is very good for the sexual power of men. Another interesting case happened in Sweden at the end of the 18th century. The tired of these discussions about coffee and tea, the king of Sweden asked two medical doctors to take two people from jail and to survey, have one of them only drink coffee every day, another one only drink tea every day, and monitor their state of health day by day. Unfortunately, first died the two doctors, one after the other, and then the king was assassinated. So we still don't know whether coffee is better than tea. Probably the one drinking coffee lived a little bit longer. But nevertheless, coffee was banished 3 times in Sweden. And again, about chocolate, the same. In Italy, for example, there was a big production of treatises about the effects of chocolate. They were, you know, nowadays we are very concerned by the interaction between science and industry, or the commercial sides of science. But for example, the company of the Indies paid a scientist to write a pamphlet about the virtues of tea and all the good effects of tea. So there were all sorts of controversies about these drinks. Let me now jump a few centuries forward and come to the Manifesto of Futuristic Cuisine, 1930. I think you're more or less familiar with futurism as a movement, but maybe you didn't know there was a Manifesto of Futuristic Cuisine. And the idea of this manifesto, you see, it's very critical with pasta, first of all. And the whole idea, and what I found interesting in this manifesto, which was published in a newspaper in Torino, 1930, by Marinetti, is the fact that science for them is an aesthetic ideal. So the futurists think that since we are in the age, they were entering the age of progress, the age of science and technology, science should follow this trend, and they associated science and technology with lightness, with fast, with everything that was fast and light, and so cooking had to become that way. So their all imagination, which, by the way, is a very powerful imagination if you think about science fiction of the 20th century, was that food would become lighter. They talk about powders, they talk about pills. I don't know if you remember Stanley Kubrick's 2001 Space Odyssey, when this astronaut has a meal, which is all powders. And of course, we know it didn't happen, but they really believed in this evolution of cuisine. Maybe I can read, because it's very funny, even if it's in Italian, I think you can understand. They actually managed to persuade some cooks to make menus and food based on this ideal. This is a very nice picture by Fortunato De Pero, who was the famous artist, which is a futuristic aperitif. So, for example, in 1931, they organized a dinner with a brodo de colla palato. This is very difficult to translate, but it's like a soup for making an airplane go up. And the Trattoria Santo Palato in Torino, so a restaurant in Torino, was making the Pollo Fiat, you know, Fiat, the car company. This chicken was, they put small pieces of iron in the chicken so that it will take the taste of iron, which was part of the modernity idea. Now, of course, this is so far I've spoken mostly about this idea that cooking has to become scientific. But Along the way, I realized there was also a strand, there was also a parallel comparison of science, of describing science as cooking, especially among scientists. This is a very nice quotation from Francesco Redi, from his works. He has just described an experiment. Francesco Redi, considered one of the founders of modern biology, he was doing what we would call comparative anatomy, I think, nowadays. So he was dissecting. In this case, he's just described the dissection of a deer brain. And after the experiment, he writes this, that he decided to challenge, again, a common sense, a stereotype, that fallow deer brain was a terrible meat, hard to eat, and noxious to the health of mankind. So that there was not a single gentleman in the court, in the Medici court where he was working, that whether for civilization or fear, dared bring a deer's brain on his table. So nobody was eating this brain. But they seeming to me beautiful and well-made brains, so again the aesthetic element, and of good substance, I took the risk, despite my servant being ashamed of taking this Lutheran villainy in the kitchen. This is probably the most terrible offense of the time, a Lutheran villainy. So he insisted until his servant cooked a solemn pan in virgin fat that came to my table piping hot and well roasted, and I frankly enjoyed it and found with reiterated true and certain experience that deer brain is a noble thing, very savory and healthy, and much better than the pig or veal brain, not to mention the dolphin brain, which to me is the finest of all brains, considering that one can eat them during Lent and other compulsory fasts. Of course, the dolphin classification was still not very clear to Redi, but here you see it's very interesting how he's combining this tasting with A and testing. So at the same time is making an experiment, because it says, which is a typical, I don't know if you know this fascinating but also criticizable book by Stephen Shaping, Life of Science, Life in Science. It's very interesting to ask the question, how do scientists think? But this is one of the ways scientists think. Everybody says it's not a good thing to eat, but I want to try myself. And if you go to Stockholm, to the Nobel Museum, I was really impressed when I saw this. They have an exhibition. Of course, they have a lot of material from Nobel. And I think a few years ago, 7 or 8 years ago, they gave the Nobel Prize for Physiology or Medicine to these scientists who discovered the Helicobacter pylori. Bacterium which seems to be associated with some types of ulcera. How do you say in ulcera? and you see actually the pill that he actually swallowed to test himself. So he swallowed the bacterium and he actually developed a small ulcera. And this is also the case of Newton's, of Bacon's famous experiment with the chicken and so on. And actually, historians of early modern science tell us that the form of the experiment actually comes from the essays or assays, which were actually, for example, the testing of a certain material or a property of material, or the testing of a certain substance. They were very cruel type of essays at the Medici court, for example, when they had to test a laxative. The Medici court were very interested in knowing whether this works or not, so they took people from the jail or people who couldn't refuse. So the idea that you try things yourself Another way, probably or apparently more sophisticated, is to compare from actually the experience of knowledge. This is by Claude Bernard, who, in his autobiography, he writes that si feuillet donner une comparaison qui exprimait mon sentiment sur la science de la vie, je dirais que c'est un salon superbe, tout resplendissant de lumière, dans lequel on ne peut pas parvenir qu'en passant par une longue et affreuse cuisine. So, the knowledge of life sciences is a wonderful salon full of light, but to reach it, you have to go through a ghastly kitchen, a smelly kitchen. This is also an interesting way. And this is a metaphor that comes throughout, especially, of course, as a way of criticizing what other scientists are doing. When a fellow scientist is doing something you don't believe or is claiming something you strongly oppose, this is from a famous controversy in geology between Lyell and Delabèche. And Delabèche is making this drawing and portraying those who follow Lyell as fooled by a smelly soup. So they don't really understand what he's saying. They're just following the smell, something which probably smells good, or they're just hungry for some explanation. This is a case which I've been studying a few years ago. Maybe you remember the cold fusion case. And here you have a lot of examples of comparing or even assimilating science, making science to cooking, both by those who criticize these two, a chemist, a physicist, Pons and Fleischmann, who claimed they had obtained cold fusion. So you see, I'm not going to read all of this, but Carlo Rubbia writes an article asking what's cooking in the test tube. The cold fusion makes us think to a cream and chocolate ice cream cone. It may be the discovery of the century, but smell of ratatouille. It was a mythical dream, and now it's like a humdrum risotto. And then fusion is not like whipped cream, again, the mayonnaise or something similar, that rises or does not rise for reason unknown to the cook. And so on. But they themselves, Pons and Fleischmann, had been using this idea. We were so enthusiastic, we decided to try in the kitchen of my house. Of course, they wanted to emphasize that everything was done with very simple tools, without the huge investment of high energy physics, and so on. And of course, then one way of science and cooking to come together is through humor, is a way of making fun of science. So this is a comic, this is another comic, Mrs. Emily Trudel. She was making a cake for the Bridge Club, and she has discovered fusion. In his scientist making cheap energy with water or with scotch, and this is somebody who has drunk too much, who's a physicist, and so on. So let me finish with a very, very classical example, but still with some points in common with the example I started from. This is from Gorgias, Plato dialogue. Socrates, through Plato, is comparing medicine and cookery. And says, cookery assumes the form of medicine and pretends to know what foods are best for the body. So if a cook and a doctor had to contend before boys or before men as foolish as boys as to which of the two, the doctor or the cook, understand the question of sound and noxious food, the doctor would start to death. And then Socrates says, I shall be like a doctor, imagining already or envisaging his accusation, tried by a bench of children on a charge brought by a cook. And of course, he imagined, so the, his idea is that, of course, cookery is more superficial, but of course it's easier for a cook, it's because the medical doctor is perceived as something very, doing something very hard for the body, while the cook is used to gorge you with abundance of nice things of every sort. So, of course, the public will always choose the cook, if it has to choose between the cook and the doctor. So, of course, I do not need to comment on the whole series of historical and contextual changes, but one thing which has remained constant from Plato to the little TV show I showed to you is this idea of the public as immature and incapable of appreciating actually science or medicine in this case. So in the case of the science TV show, it was a class of women who were fooled by a trick, and actually women, if we look at the history of popularization, were a historical target of popularization. If you remember Newtonianisme pour les dames or les entretiennes sur la pluralité du monde. Here it's boys or men as foolish or boys. So the public has always, the common sense has always to be downgraded for science to come in. I think I will stop here, and if you have questions or comments.
No res, comenceu. La paraula és vostra i ja dic si voleu fer-lo les preguntes en anglès o en italià o en castellà també, perquè ell ho entén prou bé. Diu que no ho parla, jo no estic massa convençut, però ho entén, o sigui que no hi ha problema.
Just a curiosity about all these books of science applied to cookery. If you can say something about the authors, because it seems that you require a lot of knowledge, right, of physics and chemistry to write that, right? It's not just acoustic for musical instruments. So what's the background of these authors? Were there, and if they were somehow connected with industry or something, or if their aim was just ethical and pedagogical?
Thank you. You mean this flowering of the end of the 19th century? Some of them were actually had a scientific background. There's a case, I think it was Albert Bellores, was a at a scientific training, was also teaching, I think, chemistry, was also giving cooking classes explaining this chemistry of cooking. Other were drawing on, they were popularizers, drawing on other scientific publications, and many of them were women, especially in Britain and United States. I think they had usually some connection with science, and also in some cases connection with the industry. As I said, for example, in the case of Liebig, there was he for example was using a lot these writers of cooking for advertise his product. But these books actually had a market, so it was a commercial. We know that in that period, in general, the science popularization was a big market, especially in certain countries. As I said, Mantegazza was selling 20,000, 30,000 copies of his books with several reprints, and so it was an interesting combination of forces. And of course, I didn't mention, I mean, the food industry was also changing and becoming more important in many contexts.
Well, first of all, congratulations for your presentation, because it has been very interesting, and particularly for me, the initial TV show that I didn't know, and it was really fantastic. Well, you have talked most of the time about the past, but I would like to talk more about the present, or at least the recent past years. And in our context, in our geographical context here in Catalonia, we have many cookers renowned worldwide. For example, like Ferran Adrià, I suppose you know. And there has been some movement, I think, not only here, but most in different parts of the world, that to improve the wider application of technology in the kitchen with different chemical compounds and so on. Some health force says technological gastronomy, or even molecular gastronomy or molecular kitchen, whatever, depends on the author. Well, my question is, what is your opinion about this kind of new cuisine? New cuisine not in the, like in the classical concept of French, new cuisine in the technical sense, no? Which is now applied by the famous cookers. No? Thank you.
Yes, in the last chapter, I tell the origin of molecular gastronomy. I don't know if you know this. It's quite an interesting story, which started in Italy in 1988 at in Sicily. Maybe you know Erice. There's a famous center for physics and very nice place for conferences. And they had a conference of physicists, and one of these physicists came with his wife with interest in cooking, and she started to discuss with an Italian physicist who also had an interest for cooking, was called Valdre, and they started to think about doing a symposium on physics and cooking, about what happens from the physical point of view when you make mousse or when you make mayonnaise and these kind of things. So they asked the center, and the center director said, yes, you can do the workshop, but don't call it physics and cooking, because it doesn't sound very nice in a physics center. So find a more scientific title. And they came up with this molecular gastronomy, which doesn't have any meaning. There's nothing molecular in molecular gastronomy. By analogy with the hot field of the time, which was molecular biology. And so they had a regular series of meetings, which is very interesting documentation by Harold McGee, who's a chemist, Scottish, from Scotland, I think, chemist who attended these meetings, and several scientists and chef attended this meeting, but not Ferran Adrià. He never went to these meetings. And of course, I mean, the whole phenomenon started. But at some point, I think in 2006, 2007, Ferran Adrià and other famous chefs, they wrote I think it was a paid advertisement in several European newspapers to sort of restate the supremacy of cooking over science, and saying we're not doing experimentation for its own sake. We're doing haute cuisine using science and technology. So, and this is actually part of the argument or part of the story I try to tell in the book. There's always this play about who is using what between science and cooking. So, I don't know if this answered your question, but my idea is that nowadays we have the two processes going on. So we have science using cooking, for example, to popularize itself, and we have, of course, cooking using science both from the practical point of view, like in haute cuisine in some cases, but also from a rhetorical point of view, because, of course, by using the most updated science of technology makes you more important, more updated, more contemporary. So I think it's a very interesting case, that of molecular gastronomy.
Hi. This talk is inside of the geographies of knowledge, like the whole cycle of talks is about that. I was wondering if you could say a little bit more about the space, the kitchen, about how this is related with science, or how science is produced in the kitchen.
I think, you know, when I was looking at these examples and stories, I think that until probably some point in the mid-19th century, you have many examples of activities of scientists where actually the laboratory and the kitchen are almost indistinguishable. So, for example, Pasteur. The whole career of Pasteur is constellated by themes which have to do in some way or another with food and drinks. He becomes famous by studying wine, because one of his students in Lille is the son of a famous winemaker, and talking to Pasteur, he says, we have a terrible problem because wine is going, how do you say in Spanish, I don't know, in aceto. And this is the getting going sour. Yeah, and this is the start of his interest for fermentation. And there are wonderful stories about how he becomes popular among winemakers who were very skeptical of his science in the beginning. And then, of course, chicken. His studies of chicken cholera, and we have these, especially in his popular biographies, these stories, for example, when he was making his studies of fermentation in his country residence, that he was using the old kitchen of a bistro, and his assistant was going back and forth with the tools and pots between the house and these, and of course then, relates to the title and to the Newton story, which I didn't have the time to tell. You also have the whole mythology of scientists' indifference to food, based on this idea that the scientist as an intellectual as to take a distance from the daily needs and the daily things like eating. So we have these wonderful stories of Pasteur's wife continuing calling him for dinner, and he was not coming because he's finishing his experiments, and which is actually modeled to a large extent on the saints, you know, icon, these famous stories of saints who could stay for weeks without eating. This idea that there's a wonderful quotation by Einstein that says, at some point I had to come to terms with this idea that you are part of the human beings because you have a stomach. Yes, I think actually you still find this inside. I remember when I was in Max Planck in Munich, the Institute for Molecular Biology. I remember that they were making coffee on the same I don't know the name of the tool they were using to heat the things they were using for the experiment. So.
La probeta. Il caffè nella matrice probeta.
Yes.
Thank you. I was thinking if you could tell us more about women in this particular area, because we know that for women science world has been difficult and they have been kept aside for a long time. And was this a particular oasis for them that they could do whatever, or while once science was into the kitchen, they were also a little bit kept aside?
Yes, I was reporting, I think it's a paper by an American historian who's called Rima Apple, who actually has this argument that the emergence of the so-called domestic science in certain countries was a way of diplomatic accommodation of women's aspiration in a confined space. So I couldn't say whether it was actually the case because I'm not an historian of that period, but certainly I think it might be the case. I can say there were a lot of women in that field which you couldn't find at the time in other fields. So as I said, there's also this very strong presence of women as a public of popularization I would say since the 18th century and through the 19th century at least.
Una pregunta. No. Seguendo il filo della domanda che ti ha fatto lei, perché invece nel campo dei cuochi e di questi libri su cucina scientifica, cucina che vuole essere scientifica, c'è anche un cambiamento, cioè quelli che parlano come cuochi, grandi chef dell'Ottocento che cominciano a fare questi libri, sono tutti uomini, non ci sono, cioè è un po' una mascolinizzazione della cucina. Per diventare scientifica deve essere almeno scritta nei libri e protagonizzata da uomini. Cioè quando la cucina diventa scientifica nell'Ottocento, diventa scientifica anche perché viene fatta da cuochi e non da cuoche. C'è anche un discorso anche in campo, non in campo scientifico, ma in campo dei primi chef che pubblicano questi libri, dove certamente, diciamo, era una cosa che quando non era scientifica o era prescientifica era nelle mani delle donne, e diventa scientifica anche perché adesso siamo gli uomini, che è molto simile a quello che è successo un secolo prima con la ginecologia, tutto quello che ha a vedere con il parto e la gravidanza, no? Quando non era scientifica, chirurgica, buona propria, era perché era nelle mani delle donne, poi diventa nelle mani dei chirurghi, uomini, e quindi diventa scientifica, no? Quindi c'è un bel discorso di genere, diciamo, dietro di queste storie che mi piacerebbe, se tu lo vedi così io...
Okay. Of course, that would be something you would have to study specifically, but for example, even recently, if you look, for example, at the writers of people like Hervé Thys, I don't know if you... Hervé Thys is from Belgium. He was the editor of the Scientific American, the French version. And he's one of the theorizers of this scientific cooking. He wrote several books. And he always uses this stereotype of, which is quite impressive to me, of women as an example of unconscious and unknowledgeable pre-scientific approach to cooking. I think he says something like, something really with a really negative tone that... like a little bit like in the video that I showed to you, that this cooking has still to evolve from what old women are doing confusedly, by trial and error, to something more scientific. So I would agree that this is. And also, you know, there's, I don't know if here in Spain you also have this phenomenon of TV shows about cooking. Do you have this? Of course, you have it. There's a colleague of mine from the University of Milan who has argued that because all the chefs are all men on television, and that again, when something becomes fashionable or something becomes very sophisticated, it's appropriated by men. But on the other hand, I think one of the top chefs in Italy, in South Tyrol, is a woman. I can't remember the name now. So I think it's a question of representation of science and cooking in the public domain.
Question about periodization. You said at the beginning that very consciously you organized your book thematically and not chronologically, and that seems to be the right decision. Nevertheless, I wonder, you know, in this story that you told us from 17th century to 21st century, what you know, is there some kind of periodization? How can you know, get it into shape? What has changed and why has it changed? You gave, of course, a few hints. You spoke the role of industry in the 19th century, obviously, is crucial. The rise of the laboratory and what you can do in the laboratory affects, obviously, the kitchen as well and so on. So you gave quite a few, you know, ideas. But if you had to, you know, say what were the main changes or what which one would they be? And one thing that came to my mind when you were talking about all these references between science and cooking, I had to think of Breaking Bad and Walter White, you know, who's of course a cook, you know, and I'm cooking meth, and they also in their meth lab they also do this marvelous coffee, you know, because they're such good chemists, they can make the best coffee, you know.
You're forcing me to reveal the last pages of the book, but I'm not going to reveal Newton's chicken story. So you have right to read the book. Well, to put it very crudely, as I said, this is not a book with big theoretical ambitions, but basically my idea is this, that you first have the beginning of modern science, when science is a new thing, is a new activity, so scientists to some extent are using cooking. Actually, you know, Bacon himself, who was not a scientist, was a great advocate of modern science, probably the first one to understand how science would have changed our world. He uses similar metaphors, especially related to food. Particularly, he likes the idea that science is like hunting, smelling the prey. The scientist is following the prey and smelling and looking for something good to Venazio, yes. And of course, cooking is something that the people scientists interact with are familiar, so it's a great strategy, maybe unconsciously for them, for people like Reddy, for example, no? to make themselves visible, try to explain what they do in a certain way. Then, as I say, going very schematically, I see a very interesting phase, which I tried briefly to mention, this flowering of publications about cooking in relation to science, which I see related to the already powerful presence of science in culture and in society. So science, if I can put it this way, has become chic and trendy, and this is why Artusi and other people are you know, writing about the physiology of eating, the science in cooking, even without, they don't want to do popularization strictly, but they understand science is really something they can relate to, they can use as a rhetorical resource to make known and visible and relevant what they are doing. And Artusi is basically trying to put together different cuisine traditions in Italy in a single strand. And then to come to the question on molecular gastronomy in contemporary context, I see both trends going. So I see, for example, science using cooking to popularize itself, to make it, for example, do we still have a few minutes to read something? One way of science uses cooking is to make itself more closer to common sense, less intimidating, more familiar, more funny, for example. I don't know if you know these Ig Nobel prizes. Have you ever heard about it? It's like the Nobel, but it's for real research, which have some funny, for example, 1996, the Ig Nobel Prize for Physics was given to Robert Matthews of the Aston University of Birmingham for his studies on Murphy's Law, and in particular for having demonstrated that the toast with butter often falls on the butter side. For biology, to Anders Berheim and Ogne Sandvik of University of Bergen in Norway for their paper on the effects of beer, garlic, and cream on sanguisuge? So humor is one of the ways of interacting, of making science and cooking interact. There is this wonderful fake paper by Georges Perec. Georges Perec had a great interest in science. I think he was a librarian of a research institution for a while. And he writes a fake paper, but it's exactly in the form of a paper, which is called Experimental Demonstration of the Tomatotopic Organization in the Soprano. But when you read the paper, then you realize that the paper is about if you throw tomatoes to a soprano singer, the more you increase the launch of tomatoes, the more the volume of the voice increases. And so he has a final paragraph, which is called Histology, where he writes that at the end of experiment, the sopranos would have been incubated in olive oil and Glenfiddich at 10%, and in orange juice at 15% for 47 hours, and frozen sections of 2 centimeters have been put in a delta strawberry sorbet and observed with microscopes. And he has all sorts of funny references about food. So this is a way, and of course, cooking on the other side is using science, like in molecular gastronomy or
Ti volevo chiedere due cose. Allora, una, volevo un attimo riprendere, perché noi abbiamo fatto, come ha detto Pepe prima, questo colloquio, questo ciclo di colloqui che si intitolava Piacere e ostacoli della narrativa, diciamo, di divulgazione scientifica, insomma, comunque di storia della scienza, così. E se ci puoi dire, nel caso del tuo libro, insomma, appunto, un piacere, un ostacolo, insomma, un po' così. E poi sulla, hai fatto vedere questo filmato, no? Bellissimo, di questo Piero Angela, così. Mi piace molto, no? La critica che fai, insomma, come. Però ti volevo chiedere, si può fare una divulgazione scientifica, diciamo, di. E come non dico, insomma, non la ricetta, appunto, no? Però insomma il modo di fare una cosa che non sia, diciamo, prendendo in giro le persone, facendole sembrare più stupide, perché così poi arriva lo scienziato, no? E dice come si fanno le cose, insomma.
Actually, I'm not criticizing. I'm observing, you know, as a strategy, and I think it has a number of interesting. But I think it's actually well done. This thing, it's a bit caricatural. It is full of stereotypes. But I think this is because they've chosen a certain strategy. And now. Whether it works, that's a whole different question. It depends what we mean by, there's a whole debate about understanding. Maybe people have just fun and then they totally forget. That's possible. The pleasure, and about my own writing of this, I think it was fun. I mean, it was. Normally, it's much more difficult writing academic books, but it was a lot of work. I think if you look at the references section, you see that I spent a lot of time checking the sources and tracing some books and sources, and I hope I haven't made any mistake. But so far, nobody has noticed, at least. So that part was quite stressful. But the writing itself, after I came up with this menu idea, was quite enjoyable. Before, I didn't know how to. I think it was just a pile of photocopies. I didn't know how to use. And I thought it was just boring. Tell, you know, I don't like these books that the author writes to show you that he has read a lot of other books. I didn't want to do that. I didn't see a way. Of course, I was also worried, but maybe I was just, how do you say, a bit irresponsible. I was a bit worried of my colleagues, how they would react. Like the physics center, when they said, "Don't call it." So I asked. There's a colleague of mine, one of the people I always ask to read my Renato Mazzolini. Is a very, is a great historian of science, and he said, "If this was your first book, I wouldn't publish it. But since you have already published a lot of academic books about science in society, I think this is." Great fun, and you should go ahead. So,
yes, two last questions. First of all, where we can buy the book, the first one, and the second one. This TV show does already exist now, or is finished?
It's a section of a TV show. The TV show is still going. I don't think they had for many years this section. Probably they don't have it now.
You have said
30
years.
30, more than 30. Started in 1981. More than 30. The same conductor is more than 80 years. And he doesn't have a scientific background. He didn't go to university. And
is
Rai 1. Yes, prime time, 9 o'clock. It's amazing. I think it's a unique case, probably in Europe, because as far as I know. It would be nice. And the book you can, it's not yet available in Spanish, but if you want to read it in Italian, you can buy it on Amazon or, I think the ebook is actually cheaper. If you don't find it, you email me, I can send it to you. It's going to appear in Portuguese. That's really a shame for Spain. First in Portuguese and then in Spain.
I'm able to read in Italian. Yeah, uh-huh. I understand Italian.
Wonderful.
Ya que no comenta la Emma, I want to just comment on when Einstein came to Barcelona. In you know the you know the anecdote or not? Oh well, one of the Emma knows much more than me, but one of the physics that invite him gave him a dinner, and they make a whole menu in Latin with all reference to physicists and physics and different theories and I don't know more. Emma can say more things. So, with chicken also, yeah. Yeah, it's published. Yeah, it's published. And there is also a chicken in the menu. So, yeah. So.
I want to see
it. Yeah, I think it's the original. there is also the original document, the original menu. So I think it's interesting for the next book.
For the Catalan edition is compulsory. Because
this is another interesting thing. Talking about second edition. It was very modern in that sense. It was adopting a wiki approach. So after the first edition, the first edition is self-published. Then after the endorsement, he made another edition and so started to sell a lot of copies. And then he was starting to receive correspondence from people suggesting changes or new recipes. And he incorporated that. So every edition was different. And now the edition that you find is probably the 40th or 50th with many new or a small adjustments. So,
si no hi ha més preguntes, vos agraeix molt la presència i l'activitat en el debat, Hem abusat una miqueta de la paciència de el nostre conferenciant, però la veritat és que quan el públic té ganes de fer preguntes és quan jo me n'adone que probablement les 7 de la vesprada és massa tard, perquè aquí, a més, ens volen tirar, no? Si ho farem una miqueta abans, a lo millor podríem continuar debat sense reprimir-nos les ganes perquè arriba el temps de tancar l'edifici. Gràcies, Massimiliano, gràcies a tots vosaltres i manteniu-vos atents a l'Arban, que és el nostre mitjà de comunicació per assabentar-nos de les moltíssimes coses que la societat i altres grups d'història de la ciència fan en la ciutat. Gràcies.
Gràcies.